Today is the day, my fellow mobile gamers. There's a new Clash Royale competitor in town, and this time it's a 1v1 real-time strategy game called World War Dough, which is being published by Jam City. So today we're gonna take this game for a spin, and we'll start by jumping straight into a PvP match right now, and then we'll talk about how this game plays and how it's different from its competitors, and whether or not it's actually better than the other new similar games that have been released recently, like for example Minimax Tinyverse and Magic Mana Strike, both of which I've covered here on the channel and both of which are actually surprisingly great games. So just like in every Clash Royale competitor launching these days, we've got a main hero, which is this little guy here that I'm moving around right now. He is called the Commander, and we can move him around on the map by simply tapping where we want him to go. And then of course we deploy additional units from our hand using mana, which we recover over time. So this is pretty much so far like most other new Clash Royale competitors. Of course in Clash Royale you don't actually have a main hero that you can move around. Look at this push over here on the right side, by the way. But in most new Clash Royale competitors you do have a system like that. Let's make sure to spawn a lot of units over here on the right side to take out that dino there, and we can also spawn our own dinosaur, by the way. This is the card. We just need to get 4 mana so that we can spawn it. We did take it out pretty easily though. Look at that, it's so close to dying now. There we go, we took it out. Okay, let's move our commander back a tiny bit, but the opponent has already taken out our first tower over there on the right lane right now, so we're not off to the best start. But this is where it gets interesting though, because unlike most Clash Royale competitors, we don't actually have a main tower here in World War Dough. Instead, if we can take out the opponent's commander, we will have won the match. And then of course if the match ends before we've been able to take out the opposing commander completely, then whoever has taken out the most towers, and there are 2 towers, one on each side, left and right side, will of course then win the match. So in my experience with the game, this makes it a lot more dynamic, and the objective and best strategies for deploying units will change all the time depending on where the opponent's commander is located at the moment. Right now, I don't know what our best strategy is, guys. I gotta be honest, I'm kind of just saving up for that dino to spawn, but they are spawning their dino as well, and I guess we'll just try to do a heavy push here on the left side. We only have 30 seconds left on the clock, so it's not a lot of time. Let's see if we can throw down a shield here for these guys, with our dino coming up over here on the left side as well, but they look to be dealing quite a bit more damage than we're dealing to them. I guess we can keep deploying here and hope for the best, but there's only 11 seconds left on the clock now, so it is frankly not looking too good here for us here, for the Nimble Nation. We will keep deploying units though, but I think with 2 seconds left on the clock, there's just nothing to do about this one. We lost. We will go into a new match later in this video, by the way, and we'll try to get our sweet, sweet revenge. Now, in the midst of this hectic battle here, we didn't really address the chests that also spawn on the map from time to time, which can include mana, for example, and those become their own little mini objective, of course, in their own right, which just spices up the gameplay even more. Of course, both sides will want to get those chests first, and especially in a match that's a bit less hectic than the one we were just in. So, now that we're back in town, we have got our little piggy over here, and for every win, we get 1 piggy, and when we have 3 piggies, we can break it open and receive some gold and cards for free. That is one way we get additional cards in this game and additional gold as well. We've also got loot boxes from winning, and let's go open one of those right now. We do have to wait for these loot boxes to open, so this is pretty much like in every other Clash Royale competitor. We get some new cards, we get some gold, oh, and we got a new commander card. That's pretty awesome. So in just a bit, we can go level up these cards, but first though, I'm gonna open one more of these loot boxes here, and I'm actually just gonna pay some premium currency to open it immediately, because we have some premium currency that we've earned for free, and we want to do everything we can to win the next match. So let's just open. I think we might actually have enough premium currency to open all of these 4 chests immediately, but it seems we're just getting more of the same units though. That's kind of disappointing, to be honest, guys. Let's open the last air chest here, and let's see what we're gonna get. More gold. Oh, that was a new unit, and that was a new one as well. Well, not entirely new units. I kind of had some of them already, but they weren't the same ones as this guy that we just seemed to get so many of. Major Fire. He's a nice unit though, so let's level him up a tiny bit. And you guys might notice that the UI here is very, very similar to that found in Clash Royale. Of course, many of these types of games seem to just copy that UI at this point. But as I said in another recent video, I actually don't mind that too much. This UI makes the game very easy to navigate. The menus, they all make a lot of sense. It's easy to get a good overview of the cards and so on, especially if you've played Clash Royale already. Look at this, by the way. We leveled up our commander, so now he has extra health, extra damage, and that of course also increases the damage per second. That's pretty cool. Now there's also already a guild system, by the way, and in here we can of course send cards to each other, so we can request cards from our teammates. like, for example, requesting some more of this guy. So let's request some and see if anyone from our team is actually willing to give us 10 of these cards, because then, of course, we can level it up. We can also donate, of course, cards to other guild members, and we can chat with our guild, and we can also head into friendly fights with our guild mates. I'm actually not entirely sure if we can also do that with friends, but I would assume that friendly battles is a thing in this game. I just haven't been able to add a friend to the game just yet. But fortunately, though, we are not forced to use Facebook for the friend system. We can use Facebook, but we don't have to. We can also get an invite link, and I might just share my friend invite link in a pinned comment down below this video. So if you guys want to play with me and I decide to keep playing the game, you can follow that link, and at least we can then be in-game friends. Now, let's head into another match, by the way, and see if we can get our first picky of the day. Now, this is pretty cool, by the way. There's so many different dance emotes and different cosmetics and skins that allow us to customize our character. I find that really fun. And it also communicates that the game doesn't take itself way too seriously, which I always really appreciate. Now, as for the monetization model and its impact on the fairness of the game, we can buy more loot boxes that have cards in them immediately, and just like in practically every other game in this genre, that of course does give you a pay-to-progress-fast advantage. But there's then also a $6 Battle Pass subscription service, which gives you better cards from pickies, it gives an extra VIP card in loot boxes, and it gives 2 weeks early access to new cards and just a lot of more benefits. I'm okay with most of those advantages, but having early access to new cards just sounds like a horrible monetization system. Honestly, this means that if a new card that is way too overpowered is introduced in the game, and that might happen, I mean it happened to Clash Royale, then free players could get steamrolled for 2 weeks straight by people who have this subscription service. On the flip side though, if you really get into the game, this subscription service isn't that expensive, and so you might just want to buy it as it seems to have great value for the amount of money you put into the game. I just hope that it won't ruin the ability to compete for us free-to-play players. The game does have a lot of great things going for it though. Combat is, in my opinion, more interesting and more dynamic than in Clash Royale and many of the competitors out there. There are lots of fun skins and cosmetics, so we can actually customize our character as well, and the humor of the game is just fantastic. I love games with a humorous twist, and this is definitely one of those games. It also seems we're fighting actual real players and not just bots in this game, by the way, and I say this because I was waiting in matchmaking for over a minute this morning, and the same thing actually happened during the recording of this video, but I just edited that out, and that just won't happen if the game had bots to play against. And yes, of course it's frustrating to have to wait in matchmaking, but the good thing about this system is that we know we're fighting actual players and not just bots, and I know that a lot of you guys like to know that. You don't like fighting bots in your PvP games. So at the end of the day, only time can tell how bad the monetization is actually gonna become. This game has just launched, and since games tend to monetize more and more heavily over time, now is probably the best time to get into this game and have some fun with the gameplay, as it may or may not get ruined down the road. That has happened to many mobile games, and I'm not saying it's gonna happen, but it might end up happening to this game as well. Now, ultimately, what I really like about this game is its combat system, and the fact that it's actually vastly different from Clash Royale, even though it has, of course, the same overall gameplay objective. But I find this gameplay almost as good as that found in Minimax Tinyverse, but if I had to pick one of those two games, I would still go with Tinyverse, simply because I'm more comfortable with its monetization system, despite not being too unlike what we have here in World War II. That was my take on the game, by the way, but let me know what you guys think in the comment section down below. And now it is time then for the mobile gaming news of the day, which is that after 19 freaking months in soft launch, King is now finally globally launching its RPG called Knighthood, which I covered well over a year ago at this point, and I actually had a pretty decent time with the game. So even though I'm not exactly sure what might have changed since I played it last, I would say it's worth checking out if you've been waiting for it to release. That was all for today, by the way. Thank you very much for being part of the Nimble Nation and for helping make it the most awesome community for mobile gamers right here on YouTube. Have a great rest of your day, and until next time, just keep gaming, stay awesome, and I'll see you guys around.